week, we talked about various indexing strategies. This week, we're going to start moving into optimizing query evaluation. So the core insight behind pretty much all of what we're going to be doing over the next week, probably two-ish weeks, is that there are many different ways that you can evaluate a particular expression. And the one of the main goals of a relational query engine is that you want to be able to explore and identify the strategy that's going, the algorithm or the strategy that's going to get you the best performance. And today we're going to be talking about the first step towards that, this idea that there are ways that you can tell that two different algorithms are equivalent, or in more precisely, two different relational query plans are equivalent. Before I get into that, I'd like to first congratulate 12 groups on having bested the fearsome reference implementation. 12 groups were able to outperform the reference implementation as well as be correct on every other query. So congratulations to you guys. Just to call those of you out, without actually naming specific names, there are 12 groups, and this is basically the leaderboard. So on TPCH 3, the team navigation, wait for it, base, sorry, data, wait for it, base, the data people, Impact, My Aggregate, Invincibles, Bullseye, Data Guru, Enterprise, The Usual Suspects, Moriarty, and DBZ, all managed to outperform the reference implementation. These are the relative times. TPCH 5, I was really impressed by a couple of submissions. I noticed that several of you had actually implemented hash join. Good job. You have a leg up on checkpoint 2. And I'll just give you guys a sense of how important hash join is. Up top, hash join. Up down at the bottom, reference implementation running at 210 seconds. So that's three orders of magnitude performance difference just with one relatively minor change. And we'll be talking about how to sort of get into that over the course of the lecture. Any questions? So I'm going to try and do a leaderboard like this for checkpoint 2. Unfortunately, the infrastructure is not really capable of extracting precise time measurements, but I'm going to try and do something similar that's live updated. So, all right. As I said, project submission, project checkpoint 1, would have an extended deadline in a sense. You can thank your TAs for this. The penalty has been relaxed slightly. Rather than having a fixed 6-point penalty until Sunday night, there will be a rolling penalty. So it'll start at 1 point on when it reopens tonight at midnight, and then basically tick one step every day until Sunday. So hopefully that will be a little more generous than what I originally had in mind. Any questions on Project 1? All right, cool. So before I get into the new stuff, I want to do a quick recap of what we talked about last Wednesday. So we introduced a couple of different indexing strategies, and on Wednesday we talked about the hash index. The hash index basically being based on, or the core simplest form of the hash index being a linear contiguous sequence of pages and or buckets, and you have a hash function that for every key tells you which bucket it belongs to. We noted that the hash index had a really annoying problem. What happens, we don't have precise control over this hash function, so it's entirely possible that we might end up with more data in one of these buckets than the bucket can actually hold. So in order to address that, we started looking at a couple of different ways of resizing the hash table. So remind me, what did we talk about? What were some strategies that we used on Wednesday to deal with resizing the hash table? Can you explain? Okay, so we can use the same hash function, but we can, by trimming off, or by using extra bits of the hash function, we can ensure that the hash function's mapped to the same place. What does that get us? Or what can we do with that? So if we have this deterministic way of partitioning the hash table so that individual hash buckets are split, which is what we'd get with the extra bit, what does that get us the ability to do? So if we can split one bucket, how does that, if we can consistently come up with a good mapping for a hash function that consistently splits one bucket in half, so do we want to resize the entire hash table? All of the data? No. So what is, so how does a, so you're referring to a specific data structure, right? What, how does, can you describe that, the way that data structure works? Or the, here we have a contiguous series of hash pages. What does that get? Or what's the big problem with this? We can't keep the thing contiguous, right? We can't just split one bucket at a time. So how, you're referring to the extendable hash algorithm, right? So does that actually split the entire data set? Or sorry, when I split a bucket, does that copy all of the data everywhere?
There's a pointer.
Just a pointer. Okay, so we have a level of indirection. We have one step that takes us, copy a little directory index rather than having to copy the entire thing. Right, so we have, we can keep a directory that allows us to identify we keep the data in a series of non-contiguous pages, and whenever we split, all we need to do is update this directory, this organizational structure that tells us which pages correspond to individual data values. All right. So what if we do want to actually keep the data pages contiguous? What can we do? You guys are... So do we need to split the entire... when we split the hash table, do we need to split it in its entirety? How could we potentially, yes? Okay, so in this, okay. So if we split this, will we be able to keep the pages in some sort of contiguous order? Okay, something to think about. We'll get back to that on Wednesday. In the meantime, actually, yeah, let's take a brief, we'll get back to this on Wednesday. In the meantime, let's have a quick chat on Piazza. All right, so, okay, so there's one other, we'll get back to hashing algorithms a little on Wednesday. You guys are probably crazy after the project. So we'll do this when you guys are a little more awake. Let's go with something a little bit lighter. So we talked about a couple of different hashing algorithms. One other algorithm I kind of wanted to bring up was something called consistent hashing. And if you're familiar with a system called CORD, Pastry, there's a handful of these systems that are very frequently used in content distribution networks. Amazon uses this very aggressively. The idea is basically to allow us to split things, split hash buckets in a slightly more organized way. So rather than having, rather than organizing things by individual, so the idea is basically that you, rather than trying to have all of your kind of I'm about as tired as you guys. All right, so this consistent hashing is based on something on modular arithmetic. So I keep bringing this up. The idea is based, in this case, is that the entire space of all hash values, all integers, can be placed on a ring. And in a consistent hash, the idea is basically that every bucket claims a certain portion of this ring. Now, the main benefit here is that you can manage this this data structure. You can coordinate buckets with very little management overhead, which makes it really good for distributed systems, which is where it's very frequently used. So the idea is that you, for every bucket, you assign it a random point on this ring of integers. And in modular arithmetic, when you get to the last integer, you go back to zero. So 2 to the 64th minus 1 plus 1 is 0. Right, so we have this ring of integers, and we can assign every bucket a random point on that ring. So for example, I have a bucket called A, and I assign it to a value that's about a third of the way down my number line. Pick another bucket, B, and I assign it to another point. And the idea here is that every bucket takes all of the values between itself and the previous, whatever the previous bucket is. Excuse me. So in this case, A will take all of the numbers that fall between B and A, and then B will take all of the numbers that fall between it and 0, and then 2 to the 64th through A. or back through A. Now, the nice thing about this, as I said, is that it requires very little coordination. So if I create a new bucket, I pick a new point on this ring, how much will it, or who, which other bucket value do I need to know? How much information, or what specific information do I need to know about the ring to create a new bucket? I pick a random point on the ring, let's say over there. What do I need to know in order to split this? The total number of buckets? Which buckets do I care about? The success, yeah. So I need to figure out which bucket this is, and I essentially pick a, what I'm doing every time I split, I pick a random bucket, and I fragment that in half. And the only entity that really needs to care about where I am is the whoever or whatever is controlling the next bucket, potentially also whoever is controlling the previous bucket. But the number of entities that need to be contacted is fixed, no matter how many buckets there are. And this works very well in a distributed system because you can allocate one bucket to every single machine. In this particular algorithm, whenever I split, I can always identify a single or one or two nodes that will help me split. For every split, I only need to contact a fixed number of nodes rather than contacting the entire network. That would be quite inefficient. So the idea basically is that All right, so essentially the main benefit here is that every time I split, I only have to contact a fixed number of nodes. At most, one bucket when I split, two buckets when I merge are affected by this. The downside is that this sort of mapping ends up being a little expensive. Figuring out which nodes map to which buckets. So there's been a fair amount of work back in the early 2000s, late 90s, on ways to improve the performance of this and ways to implement it. And if you're interested, I encourage you to look up either CORD or PASTRY is another one. Okay. So let's recap a little bit how indexes end up getting used. So if you recall, on Wednesday, we talked about different ways to implement lookups on indexes. So as an example, by now, you should have some familiarity with this idea of a file scan operator and a selection predicate. We observed that you could take a selection predicate and kind of insert it into that file scan if you have an index over the appropriate predicate. And that allows us to improve the performance of that file scan by only finding the index nodes that we're specifically interested in. Similarly, if we have a file scan plus a join operator, two file scans feeding into a join operation, or more precisely, one file scan feeding into a join operation, what we can do is build the join operation as a nested loop join, but inside the nested loop, rather than doing a scan over the entire relation S, we can do it over the tuples of S, only those tuples of S that match the predicate that we're interested in. Okay. So getting into the sort of core theme of today's lecture, the ideas that we're going to be talking about today are going to be mostly there for project, or sorry. This is basically going to be one of the central themes of Project 2, Checkpoint 2. So as a way of sort of introducing this, I want to kind of give a couple of motivations and a high-level overview of Project 2. So there are basically going to be two major challenges in Project 2. It'll, for the most part, it'll be essentially the interface, the way everything works will be practically identical to Project 1. The main difference is that there, the queries that you're going to get and the amount of time that you'll have compared to the reference implementation will be lower. And there are going to be two different things that you'll need to do to account for that and improve performance. So the first is going to be managing memory. And 2 weeks ago, we already talked about different ways of different algorithms that gracefully handle low memory usage. The big one was the sort algorithm. So we talked about two-way sort, and we talked about a couple of ways of improving that. The two other major things that you'll need to look at are aggregation and join. And there's a couple of different ways that we talked about improving those. So, and the last thing, you guys have by now noticed that TPCH 5, TPCH 3 are rather expensive queries. They take a while to compute. Can anyone suggest why that's the case? Too many joins. So the joins are expensive. But why are the joins expensive? So in the reference implementation, very little gets materialized that needs to be materialized. But so what does a join do? If I have data of size n, one input of size n, one input of size m, how big is my output? N times m. So if so, essentially multiplying the number, the size of my data. If I have four tables, I'm joining them together. How big is four tables of size n? I'm joining them all together. How big is my output? N to the fourth. So joins are typically going to massively increase the size of your data. And going back to the first lecture, one of the really important things that a database tries to do while optimizing is minimize the amount of data that that it's using. And so we're going to be looking at how you can take a relational query plan. I'm sure you've noted, so I've had a couple of people come to me and actually note that in some of the queries, you could take a join operator and swap it with a selection operator. And that drastically reduced the runtime of their algorithm for one specific query. Today, we're going to be talking about how that generalizes a bit. And to by the end of this lecture, I kind of want to fill in this last block here. We're going to have you guys are going to have a sense of how to take a relational algebra query plan and find a set of equivalent plans that are potentially going to have better performance. So to illustrate the basic idea behind this, I want to get this idea across to you. And so using Spock, there are basically two different kinds of Spock. There's the good Spock that exists throughout the majority of the series, and then in a couple of episodes we see an evil Spock. He looks the same, except he has a beard, but he's evil. Only good, evil. Two very different characters. They may look the same, but they're very different. Conversely, we've got the new Star Trek franchise as Zachary Quinto playing Spock, as opposed to Leonard Nimoy playing Spock. These two are very different in appearance, but they are fundamentally the same character, different people's views on Star Trek notwithstanding. So just to draw a parallel here, there are very different types of relational algebra expressions, and we'd like to be able to find out which relational algebra expressions have the same semantics, mean the same thing. And once we can do that, we can take, we can sort of branch out, we can find different expressions that effectively mean the same thing, but are going to be much, perform much better. Now these rewrites, now these equivalencies that we're going to be talking about today kind of fall into two different categories. Some of them are always a good idea. So there's a very, very clear-cut set of cases where you actually want to transform this expression in a particular way. And in a couple of them, they might be a good idea. Which is to say that there are some circumstances where they can reduce your performance, and there are some circumstances where the rewrite or the equivalence can improve your performance. And so really the core question that we're going to try and answer today is how do we get to these sort of equivalent forms? Okay, so quick show of hands, who here has taken a class on algebra, and I mean not high school algebra. I mean sort of algebra as spoken by a mathematician. Okay, so here's your quick 2-second introduction. And algebra is a sort of language with a set of operators. Be precise here. Certain kind of operators can be classified into certain categories. So, show of hands, who has heard the word commutative? Okay, good. So, commutativity is one specific class of equivalence. It means that we can take two different orderings of the operator and reorder the operator in reverse. So as an example, if I have a selection, if I'm filtering out based on one condition, then I filter out based on a second condition, I can equivalently say that I'm first filtering out by the second condition and then, or sorry, first by the first, you know what I mean, you can flip the order. We talked about decomposition of ands the other day, and projection. So can anyone tell me why this is the case? Why if I project project down to one set of columns and then project again down to another set of columns, I can just ignore most of those projections and cut it down to a single one. Yes?
So those things must still be included in the ones inside of that in order for that outer most one to work anyway.
Yep. So each projection is effectively removing things from your set of attributes. So you can get rid of everything except the last one because everything in this has to be present in all the rest. Join also has some nice properties. It is associative, so you can reorder parentheses however you see fit, and it is commutative, so you can reorder the join order as well. All right, now I want to get you guys kind of thinking in the right mindset here. So let's take about 4 minutes, and I have two different formulas here. And I want you to prove to me, using the rules that are described here, using this is equivalent to this, this, so forth, prove to me that this expression, R join parentheses, S join T close parentheses, is equivalent to T join R close parentheses join S. You can talk to your two or three nearest neighbors for this. All right, anyone have a solution? Yes. Sorry. Go ahead. Okay, so I've got R join S join T.
So we put the commutative rule on S cross S join T.
Okay, so what does that get me?
R join.
So does everyone buy this? Start with R join S, I apply commutativity, flip those two, and then flip the parentheses, and then flip those two. Any questions? Okay, so the most of what we're going to be doing here is trying to find different ways of exploiting these equivalence rules to rewrite expressions in such a way that they make more sense, that they can be evaluated more efficiently. Now, in this particular case, T join R, we don't necessarily have a good sense of the performance, the relative performance of each of these. But one thing that I would like you to think about is, over the course of the rest of the class, is how we can figure out which of those would perform better. So that said, let's take a quick 5-minute break. Be back here at 5:40, and we'll get to the rest of the class. These equivalencies that I'm describing here are all within a given operator. So selection is commutative. Join is associative. But what we haven't discussed so far is what happens when you combine different operators. So our relational algebra is essentially the idea is that you can treat all operators more or less uniformly. So we want to come up with an equivalent set of equivalencies for inter-operator expressions. So the first of these is basically that selection and projection can commute. Can anyone see where there might be a problem with doing that, swapping the order of a selection and a projection? Go ahead.
Guys.
Okay, so if you project away certain attributes and then you do a selection based on those attributes, then, well, you're stuck. So the first rule is that selection commutes with projection under certain circumstances, namely that you can't swap the order of these operators if the selection predicate depends on columns that are projected away. Just going to circle that. All right, so quick group work. Find your nearest neighbor, take about, let's say, 2 minutes, and prove to me, given the rewrite rules that we've discussed so far, that expression is equivalent to that expression. Take about 2 minutes. Discuss amongst yourselves. Anyone have a solution? Yes. Okay. Okay, so, well, we can get rid of multiple projection operators stacking on one another. We can't necessarily, there's a selection operator sitting in the middle there, so we don't necessarily know precisely how that interacts with the rest of the process. So, intuitively, I believe you are correct, but I am a computer here. You need to prove to me precisely, using the rules that we've determined, that this is correct. Yes. Okay. So where is? So should we start with the right hand side? Okay. So starting with the left hand side. Okay. Okay, so using the previous equivalency, we can, this is equivalent to, so by the one of the previous rules, we get this. Okay, what now? Yes? Okay. Okay, why is this okay? What, why is this an acceptable, would it, state again your motivation for this? Can you state again why this is a legitimate operation, transformation? You said it before, I just want you to repeat it. Okay, so we're applying this rule, and but there's a condition on that rule. Is that condition satisfied? Okay, so because of the fact that all of the, we've explicitly said all of the columns of, what if we were to get rid of that? Would these two be equivalent if it was just pi A? No, okay. So, great, you guys, so when would we actually want to employ a rewrite like this? So does this work? Yes. Was that a hand or just stretching? Okay. Guys, can you please stop talking? I'd like to be able to hear you guys as well, but one at a time. Yes. Okay, so it reduces the size of each tuple. That's pretty much the main advantage of this operation. This specific kind of pattern around selection is not always a great idea, but the same exact kind of pattern occurs in a lot of places. So you should be on the lookout for operators that... What if we were to replace the selection operator with, let's say, an aggregation operator? Sorry, that doesn't type check. Join operator. Think about it. In fact, think about it very quickly. Okay. So the next observation is that the join operator is essentially defined. By definition, a join is a selection on top of a cross product. So whenever we encounter selection plus cross product, we can always replace that with a join. One thing to observe here is that usually this kind of replacement only helps if there's a good way to evaluate join sub C. So if we have some complex condition, this is not necessarily going to be all that helpful. So let's go through another quick exercise. And this one should be a lot easier. So can anyone prove to me that these two expressions are equivalent? All right, let's take, 2 minutes. Selection was decomposable, decomposed, and we had a rule that said selection was commutative. So, we commuted. Okay? Ace Project 2, right? I'm not hearing a single question from the audience. That means you guys get it, right? Okay. All right. So when would we want to apply this transformation?
We don't want it to fit the entire class.
When we, okay, so this is always a good idea. This is sometimes a good idea. Probably always. Always. Okay. So, short version, yes, but as long as we have a good way of performing a join on the condition C. So if, in this case, if we didn't have an index, it wouldn't make much sense to push R dot A is greater than 3 into the join. That doesn't really help us perform the join. So performing a selection predicate on top of it, on top of a cross product would basically be equivalent. Okay, next equivalency. Selection can commute with, or sorry, can be pushed into a cross product, again, under certain conditions. Yes? Oh, sure. Mm-hmm. Describe to me the algorithm that you would use. So the question here is, why shouldn't we push R dot A is greater than 3 into the join algorithm? So we're using nested. We talked about a couple of different join algorithms so far. Hash join works under certain circumstances. We're doing inequality on the things. We talked about index nested loop join. We talked about a couple of different joins. So, you're proposing to, but the thing with each of those join algorithms is they work on a very specific class of conditions. So a hash join works on equality join and equality join and several equality joins, potentially. Now, you're completely right that I could come up with an algorithm that would perform this join. But it wouldn't precisely be hash join or pre-index nested loop join. So what I'm asking you to do is to describe to me what that algorithm will look like. We do a standard nested loop join, but whatever hash join or whatever, but every time we read a tuple, we first check to see if it satisfies a condition. I want you to hold on to that thought for precisely one slide. So this may be getting at, I think this is getting, well, I know this is getting at precisely what you're describing. The filtering, what you're effectively doing is filtering out that join, filtering R before you apply the join condition. And you can describe that as a specialized algorithm, but you can also describe it as, in a more general way, as applying a selection predicate to R before applying the join. You follow? So, more precisely, under certain circumstances, we can take a selection predicate, in this case, select C, and we can actually push it into the join operation. Now, this lets us keep the join operation a little more modular, while at the same time getting the same expressive power. So this works in pretty much the same way as before. There's a obvious case where this doesn't work. Can anyone say what it is? It's written up there.
Well,
someone? Bueller? Yes. Right, so if there's any attribute in the selection condition that appears in S, then we can't push it down into the R side. Similarly, if there's a condition, if there's any attributes referenced in the condition that that come from R, we can't push it down into the S side. So if we're looking at conditions only on one of the two relations, we can always take this relation and push it, this selection predicate and push it down one side of the join. So let's do another quick group work. I have a expression here. Prove to me that these two are equivalent. Talk amongst yourselves for 2 minutes or so. Yes. Thank you. No, it means C prime, a different condition.
Oh, okay.
Sorry. So I was yes. Are they? So join and cross product, as we've established, are different things. Yes. Thank you. Why? Okay, so we need to know something about these. You're awake. Great. So we need to know something about C. What is the something? Okay, so the condition C needs to be exclusively needs to exclusively apply to attributes in R. Let's hypothetically say that that's the case. Take another minute or so, and assuming that C applies only to is only evaluated over attributes in R, prove to me that these two are equivalent, keeping in mind that join and cross product are different. You're right that they're the same. They appear to be the same rule, but I want you to using all of the knowledge that you gained up to this point, I want you to prove to me that the same rule can be applied to joins. Anyone have a solution yet? Selection is commutative, so we can flip the order of the selections. Okay, so then we apply the above rule, and that gets us. You can decompose the join into its component parts, swap the order of the selection predicates. That's safe to do. You can then push the inner selection into the join, and this is where that condition would be violated if you were applying it. And then finally, you can reconstitute the join from its component parts. Great job. So you've given yourselves another tool, another rewrite rule that you can use. We're running a little short on time, so I want to get to the next one. Let's skip that. So the second operation there, all of these slides are on Piazza. The second condition there, I'd like to see a solution on Piazza for baked goods. Okay, so quick question. When is this rewrite a good idea? Both of these rewrites are more or less equivalent. When is it a good idea? I missed parts of that. Whenever you can apply it, this is a great idea. This is basically one of the most fundamental rewrite rules of relational databases. Pretty much every single database system is going to implement this one way or another. The earlier in your computational pipeline you can get rid of data, the better. And this gets rid of a whole lot of data. So this is, if you take away nothing else from this lecture, project 2, this needs to get implemented one way or another. Okay. One other rewrite rule. So we can take projection and we can also decompose that over the cross product operation. We of course have to have a way of splitting the attributes down into individual. Are there any questions? I'm hearing a little chatter. Before I move on. Any questions? All right. Yes.
Can you
do you have that when you rewrite the query, it will run faster? This gets back to something I said earlier on. The short version is you don't, at least not yet. There are certain rewrites that are pretty much guaranteed to reduce the amount of computation that you need to perform. So in this case, let me get back to that slide. Here. Okay, so for a rewrite like this, what's the working set size? How many tuples are going to be processed by the left-hand side operation? N cross, well, it's going to be a little less than N cross N, but you're going to be processing all of the tuples in the output of the join. So you're performing the join on, you're doing all of the work of the join on all of the tuples. That whatever join algorithm you're using, you're doing all of the work. You're then filtering out some subset of those tuples. In the second, on the right-hand side, you're essentially filtering out tuples before they hit the join. And because the join is the more expensive of the two operations, you're pretty much guaranteed that the right-hand side operation is going to perform better. Not always the case, but it's a reasonable heuristic to assume that the right-hand side operation will perform better. In the case of other rewrites, I actually want you to hold that question for three or four slides. Actually, fewer. Okay, so you can push down projection as well. Usually this is a good idea. Maybe not necessarily as much of a good idea as selection, but you can push down projection. This can sometimes reduce the amount of data that you need to cart around. It can also increase the amount of work you need to do. So this you need to experiment with sometimes. Another thing for Piazza, since we're really running short on time, I'd like to see a proof of this. And again, under what conditions? Right. Okay. So the last thing, we talked about join being associative. So this is pretty much the most, the trickiest of the optimization rules, the equivalencies to apply, for the simple reason that which of these is better? The answer is my favorite phrase in responding to you guys, so. Yes, it depends, thank you. So which of these is better? It depends, and it depends on a lot of things. And so this is gonna be the main focus of the next two or three lectures. How do we figure out which of these two is better, and how do we essentially get to a point where we can evaluate these queries efficiently? So thanks a lot, and see you on Wednesday.